First, let me apologize for the delayed start. A little bit of hiccup this morning. But nonetheless, we are all here now to celebrate the life of a wonderful son, father, husband, brother, and friend. As such, we're going to proceed with the program as planned. I'm asking you to go by the program. If your name is on the program, I'm going to ask that before you are even called, I'm going to ask you to come down. There's a chair here and a chair there. One to the right, one to the left. So the first person to do something will come on the right. If you know you're next in line, you'll come on the left. So we can move through smoothly. It is being streamlined. So as a result, let us flow, flow, and flow. Oh, sorry. As many of you know, some may know me as James, but not many persons know that my name is actually Deval, Doval, Duval, Dweval, David, Omarr, James, Stell. If I didn't know that, we could have moved on. But actually, the name is just David, Omarr, James, Stell. And many of you know me as Omarr Fogo's brother and friend. And it's my honor today to share my thoughts about his life with you all. But before I go any further, I'm going to introduce to you Pastor Dr. Leroy Campbell, who will give you the opening sentence and who will be taking the sermon today. Welcome him as he comes to the podium.
I'm happy to be here with you in what many could consider a sad occasion. But the reality of it is that memorials are based on what you choose to make of them. We can remember good things and we can remember things that make us sad. So I hope today as we proceed that we would invest our energies and remember the wonderful gift that our brother has been to us, and that this would be an experience of thanksgiving and worship for the goodness of God. I ask you all to stand and let us bow our heads in prayer. Blessed Father, come before you this morning at this blessed occasion. You have granted us the opportunity to gather together in order to celebrate and to memorialize this wonderful gift that you have given to us. Lord, everyone that is here would have been partakers of this gift. We pray for a special blessing for each and every person in this room. We pray for strength to those who are grieving most and feeling pain. And as we proceed through this service, we pray for the Spirit of God to rest in this place. We pray for your strength to counteract every force of confusion, every principality, any power that would seek to disrupt you, put under subjection to the blood of Jesus Christ. And we pray that we'll have a smooth and worshipful experience, and all glory and all honor will be to your name. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. Amen. Bless you all.
Please remain standing and we'll tune our voices and sing from our program, I Come to the Garden Alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear calling out my ear, my son of God.
Good morning, everyone. I
come to the garden alone. While the dew is still on the roses, and the birds I hear calling on my name.
this, you may be seated. When we call upon Ms. Rosemary Fogo, who was Kevin's aunt, to now read our first lesson, which is taken from St. John chapter 14, verses 1 through to 10. Remember, we're asking Mr. Kevin Morgan to stand by the left.
Good morning, everyone. First lesson is taken from St. John chapter 14, from 1 to 10. Praise God. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, ye know, and the way ye know. Thomas said unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. If he had known me, he would have known my Father also. And from henceforth he knew him and had seen him. Philip said unto him, Lord, show us the Father, and it sufficeth us. Jesus said unto him, Have I been so long with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that had seen me had seen the Father. And how sayest thou, then show us the Father? Ten times. Believe thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me.
If you can hear me, I just like to greet you in the name of the Lord. Now, I am standing here with mixed feeling. Yes. When you hear the present, my brother here said, Clement Morgan from Old Elbow, come with a song. I would dare not sing a song before I really tell you my connection with Mr. Fogo and Andrea. Way back, it's many years now. And you're born and partially grew up in Bully Tree, Old Elbow. I was just living about 2 miles down the road from her. Here come my brother, younger brother. He went to school, Davis Primary. And they met from about in grade 1. And they fell in love with each other. That is my youngest brother. He was not more than about 6 or 7 years of age. And every day, almost every day, he would invite Andrea to find their way up to our house, and we treated her like we were one, and we didn't know that we were not so much close. And then, all of a sudden, the mother started to send Andrea clothes in a little bag until Andrea found herself living with us until she was about 16 years of age. Andrea became a part of my family. And here is Manny sitting right there. And we have another 2 other brothers. The one that actually took Andrea to our house, he passed on before us.
I need to be on this one. And from that day, every time Andrea leaving from Kingston, she found herself in Old Harbor, Margaret. And everybody who knew Andrea from Kingston would hear that Andrea said, "We're going to Old Harbor to look for my family." And Omarr would travel with her. This is the kind of relationship that we have experienced over the years. And I am here today. I really, really want to sing, but I don't know how to begin. But anyway, I'm going to try. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. Praise God, praise God, praise God.
For the time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine, instead to suit their
praise God, praise God, praise God. Demsha, on behalf of the father and family in Canada, to read a tribute. Odin? Odin? Not ready. We'll move over to Maisha Smith. Naisha Smith. It says Maisha on the program. This is Fogo's sister. Welcome her, please.
Good morning, everyone. And I wanted to say thank you so much for coming, because this is truly, like, this is my first experience. I've never lost anyone so dear to me. And to know that I had 29 years of my life with Omarr Fogo, how do I adjust myself? Only God knows. But we will take it one day at a time. I just wanted to say, yesterday I went on the road and there was a message that was given to me. And the message that was given was, my mess is my qualification. Which means it can be interpreted in multiple ways, but in this particular experience, my brother is who made me who I am and the person that I am. And best believe we're opposite, because he's an extrovert and I'm an introvert. So you know that relationship. Anyways, he's the one who scolded me and provided me with the personality that I have, because if you know Omarr Fogo, even though he's somewhat quiet, when you get him to be himself, he is phenomenal. And that's where we're here celebrating the Thanksgiving of Omarr Fogo today. Now, with the message that was given, our mess is what qualifies us, which means it is experience like this that builds us for the better tomorrow, right? And sometimes we have to have downfall in order to appreciate and understand how precious life is. And it is a preparation to qualify whatever purpose God put us here on the earth for, whatever purpose that is. And honestly, I don't know what I'm going to do tomorrow. I'm just trying my best to cope as much as I know how to. And most definitely, I'm trying to keep strong for my mother, because the reality is she not only has me. So she has me and Omarr Fogo, so now she looks forward to me. She looks forward for strength from me. So it is something that it's a big responsibility, but I have to hold it, right? With the message being given, though, I remember the other day, I think in May, I wanted to go at a new role at my job, because previously I was a team lead. And of course, the first person I called was Omarr, and I said, I need to do this. What do you think about it? And he said, give it a try. And then, of course I did. And after doing the first interview, I told him, and he said, okay, good job. And I did the second interview, and he said, nice, my sister. So when I finally got the opportunity, of course, I shared it with him. And he is the one that developed my skills. He is the one that mentored me. No, I no longer have that opportunity. I no longer have that go-to person. I could call Kevin for anything. And I would say, Kevin, you can't talk to your mother. And he would say, what's wrong now, Naisha? And I would share it with him, and he would say, come on, Naisha, you know what's your mom is here. Just work with the flow. So to know that I no longer have this is just really heartbreaking. And all of God knows, all of God knows. This is to say, everyone uses the experience to appreciate how life is precious to each of us. And Kevin will always be in our memory. He will always be in our heart. And for me personally, having someone around from the day I was born to know is just, it is, to me, it's unacceptable, but it is what it is and life goes on. They always say two things is guaranteed in life, and that is tax and debt. So keep strong, everyone. And I appreciate you guys being here today. Thank you.
Spoken like a true trained child of Fogo.
That's true.
I have to correct Naisha. She made one mistake. She said it's only she alone is left with mommy. And that's not true. Can you get all the brothers to please clap? Fogo was never alone. And as such, I want to give you a message, and this is not just to Auntie White, Mommy, or to Naisha, but also to Mrs. Fogo and his children and grandchildren.
Lean on me when you're not strong.
On behalf of the Davidson and the residents of Paradise Court, of which Mr. Fogo was a resident, we're left with memories of time past, struggling to accept that you're not gone. Though we know our time on earth is short and it feels like time spent was not enough, we thank God for the memories we have, the many laughs. There was so much laughter. Your jokes brought us so much joy. Your laugh was truly hilarious, contagious. We miss your laugh. We thank God for the sacrifices you made for us. Thank you. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for all you taught. Thank you for all your support. Thank you for the encouragement that stuck with us to this day. It can be done. It can be done. We tell our friends, we tell our children while we think of you. We love you forever and think of you each day, waiting for a phone call, a text, a joke, something. This hurts, but we know God is perfect and made no mistakes. So here we are, left with memories. We hold them dearly. We cry, we mourn because we love you. We're grateful we have the chance to love you and to be loved by you. We miss you, we love you, and we always will. But we do not mourn today as those without no hope, because we know who our hope is in, and it's in King Jesus. These are a few words in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Beautiful words. In the interest of time, we'll be moving over with the next hymn. We'll skip the next hymn for now, and we'll move to the remembrance, which will be done by Garfield Appleby, another brother of Omarr Fogo. May I just add that this is not just any brother, this is the big brother, not just in height.
Morning, everybody. This, an artist, over 30 years of friendship, and never expect this. Yeah? Life of a man is not defined by the number of days spent on this earth, but by his works during the days spent on this earth. We are but visitors on this earth, and we serve a purpose once we are given life in some way or form. Over 30 years of friendship, knowing Omarr Fogo, we've been through a lot. I mean, school, left school, worked at BKB downtown. Whilst at BKB, Fogo found this calling where we do see each other. We will always have all those memories of growing up, coming together. And I must say, from the Scotts family, the day before Fogo died, we talked on the phone. I was on a course. And I'm telling him, Fogo, we cannot talk now. And now, my wish, we did have the conversation about it. It what? Raquel, Mommy, just know that. All you have to know, Allah. When you get one away, you get all away. I'll always be with you, no matter what. Thank you.
Hear, hear. Totally agree. At this, we're going to be calling Ms. Stephen Walker on behalf of the Bible Way Apostolic Trenchtown to bring a special tribute. Sorry, Mr. Stephen Walker. Don't have my glasses here.
Morning. Friends, family members, I'm not Stephen. And Derek.
Stephen, unfortunately, is not feeling well and is not able to make it today. With all the pleasantries acknowledged, we want to, you have heard the niceties, you have heard the pleasantries, you have heard the stories that are on the front page, what you can see. I want to take this opportunity to remind us of what we have not seen, and that is the dirty work that is done behind the scenes by Omarr Anthony Fogo, affectionately known as Kevin. The dirty work of being the son that he is to his mother. The husband that he was to his wife, Raquel. And the father that he was to his children. That is not work that sometimes we celebrate, because it is not work that we see. And if you know Kevin, you would know how much that work meant to him. It is not easy. If you see Kevin, you would see someone that is very big, but you will stand in a room and you will not hear him. But when he does speak or does something, you know. He doesn't speak often, but when he speaks, it is always something that you can use to either execute a project or to take away with you for further use. He was not someone who spent a lot of time talking gibberish, because some of us, that's all we do, speak gibberish. Things that once it has come out of us, it no longer has any value. Kevin was not that person. A man of few words, but a very, very big action. And that is what we want to remember him today, as we celebrate his life. We from the Bible Way Church of God have lost a brother. We have lost a family member. But heaven has gained a saint. Walk, boy, keep it.
That's right. Heaven has gained a saint. And this will now call upon Beryl Savage from the Trenchtown Past and Present Cadet Group to bring a tribute on behalf of Foxtrot Company, namely Trenchtown Comprehensive High School, Stats, and Kingston Senior, which is now Kingston Secondary.
Omarr the Skiffler. And then you have the beast when he gets on the Parade Square. It's two different persons. In talking to several past cadets, one of the things that we heard is, yes, man, he'll kill you with joke. He'll do everything. He'll be jovial, he'll be nice. And then you go on the Parade Square and it's a different person. He becomes ultra competitive. He always wants to come out as being the best driller. He wants to come out and perform. For those who don't know, he was a force corporal, force order corporal at his two stripes. But at one point he was the Q here at Trenchtown. You might be forgiven to think that Trenchtown was his original high school home, but to remember, he came from Clan Carty and it's Cadet that brought him here.
That's right.
I remember I can hear somebody saying, boy, they went on a non-commissioned officer's course, an NCO course at Halliwell, and they found Fogo suffering from ego. And somebody had to strip him and they had to apply body heat to get Fogo back. And then when Fogo wake up, Fogo said, yo, my fine smarty bunch up for me. And then get a nickname from that. But Cadet was, and you know the funny thing, for everybody who's a cadet, you can basically just copy and paste, and especially if you're a Trenchtown cadet. There are two versions of being a Trenchtown cadet. There's a Trenchtown Comprehensive High School cadet, and then there's a Trenchtown High School cadet. But the standard, the pride, the honor, the camaraderie, the love, and the unity, that is what runs through everything. Discipline, the attention to detail, the regiment that he learned as a cadet, that has transitioned into his regular life. Fogo was shaped by his external experiences, but more so by his cadet experience. Cadet is what took a lot of us, and I think I can expand it here. Cadet is what took a lot of us from being just regular, normal people and made us into somebody today. I mean, I don't have to say anything, right? Amen. When I joined Cadet, I remember I used to run up and down in my tier category. I used to skull school. I used to do all those things. And then I found somebody who said to me, no man, come join my crew. And that changed my life. And I am 1,921.5% sure that is what happened to Fogo as well. Joining the cadet changed him, made him a better person. And with that said, I know that the life he lived from the moment he joined a cadet was a successful, was an impactful, was a committed, was inspirational, and was to some a challenging life. And the people that are here bears testimony to that. I would just like to step back now and just, after three, ask everybody just to stand and to just give a salute to Fogo. I will give the command. The command will be, all cadets salute, and then you salute after three.
You may be gone, you'll never be forgotten. Amen. You may not be standing here with us, but your memory stands tall. You may be laying down, but your character, your strength, your leadership, your guidance, your love, your respect stands tall. You have a seat amongst those that people look up to. You are Omarr Anthony Fogo. Farewell, my friend.
Put your hands together again for that tribute. That was not an ordinary tribute. I think Odin Demso is here. Oh, the tribute is not finished. Round two.
If you stand up for those down on
cadet, you know that you never have a march path without a display. So how could I not realize you're a follower? At this, Fogo's dad is not able to travel, Mr. Raphael Anthony Fogo, but he sends his tribute, which will be read by Odin themselves, all the way from Canada. So I don't ask him to come to read this tribute.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
I was prepared to read my tribute first, and as such, I'll ask if you'll permit me to do so first. Now, coincidentally, I listened or I learned of that song 2 weeks ago, and when I was asked to bring or convey my tribute, I was saying, if I had a voice, I would have sung it for Uncle Kevin. But that is not my piece, so I decided to leave it, right? But those who know the lyrics of the song can attest that this really is who Uncle Kevin was, and there's definitely a place for people like him in our hearts. Physically, he's not with us anymore, but he's always in our hearts. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Uncle Kevin was respected and a respectable family man. He was revered by his family, community, and groups as humble and jovial. Not true?
Yes.
To the best of my knowledge, he never stepped foot in a heart institute for cooking or hospitality. Yet, those who stayed by the Fogo's Inn can attest to his remarkable, and apologies, Sister Fogo, superior cooking and hospitality skills. Is this true?
Yeah.
He was welcoming and unselfish. He never entered the comedy bus, at least to my knowledge. But we could always depend on him for a good laugh to uplift our spirits with one of his stories. Is that so?
Yes.
To us, we were robbed an additional second, minute, hour, or day with a father, a son, an uncle. But he wouldn't see this so. And so we thank God for lending. Can we say lending, church?
Lending.
For lending him to us. A remarkable human being, my Uncle Kevin. Thank you. I will now read the tribute from Uncle Kevin's father, which was sent all the way in Canada. Apologies. Alright, so these are the words from Mr. Fogo. Son, no farewell words were spoken. No time to say goodbye. You were gone before I knew it, my beloved son. I will cherish the memories, your laughter, the way you say daddy during our regular conversations. Rest in peace, my son. Sadly missed, but never forgotten. Raphael, Donna, Charmaine, Dwayne, and Tamara. Thank you.
Well said. Well said. And now one of the moments we've all been waiting for. The youngest daughter of Omarr Fogo. Omarr Fogo and her friend Talene Fisher
is now going to be doing a nice item for you on behalf of her dad. Give them a round of applause as they come. Until today. Omarr Fogo loved life and family and created many bonds of friendship wherever life took him. While growing up on Galloway Road with his mother and sister Naisha Smith, Omarr Fogo had a special family bond, not just with his mother and Naisha, but his friends, Dale, Ricky, Shane, and even Dylan, which is Shane's older brother, which was further extended through Kenneth to myself Malcolm, Appleby, Atlan, Laidlaw, Bennings, Bloomfield, Biggs, Karen, and the entire Foxtrot Company, as I cannot name all. At the time, Trenchtown was a part of a company combined with Trenchtown Stats and Cases, three units together in one. Sorry. This family bond then moved to be extended in 1996, where Omarr had his first real employment. Along with myself, Appleby, Atlan, Karen, and Shane, at the Downtown Kingston Management District, DKMD, where another family bond was forged and extended to include Seraphia Green, Winston Wilson, Claudine Reed, to what became a much larger family known as the Era Youth Crew, a performance arts company in 1997. In Era Youth, Fogo forged another family bond with not just his peers, but the late Orlando Casper Anderson, Chicken, Pinky, Petrie, Theo, Tommy, Castello, Swaby, Maja, but also our mentors, Sheila Graham, Blacker Ellis, Bella Bell, Umbala, Hillary Nicholson, to name a few, as once again I cannot name them all. While Fogo gained several awards during his years as a cadet, both in school and work, and his school work, cadet training to include most outstanding cadet 1995. He'll never enter a parade without his boots burnished to the tune whereby he could see his own reflection in it. His life gained a greater foundation after that, while he entered the Era Youth Crew, formerly the Era Boy Project, where he performed at the prestigious World Theatre in the beatification of Era Boy. This being his only performance on stage, because as life would have it, Fogo found his calling when he entered into the lighting booth at the World Theatre. Lighting became his career choice, while he later set up his own lighting company and provided not just stage lights for his live performance, but also for media houses in Jamaica. Many persons will not have known that Fogo was an apprentice in the popular film, The Third World Cup, but his lighting experience led him to being the person behind the scene, working with a professional lighting technician. And that spiraled his career. He then moved on to working at Intech Jamaica and forged another family bond, but this time with Cleon, who from that day until now remains his brother, friend, colleague in the lighting industry. I reflect on the days that as we prepare for camping in Hollowell or Mavis Bank, Fogo, myself, and sometimes several others would walk from Trenchtown Comprehensive High School to Tivoli Gardens to visit his uncle, Barrington Fogo, who many of us thought was his dad, to collect our pocket money. These funds we used to use it to jump on a bus, and we would stop by Grinch Farm where I live for us to pick up my bags, and then jump on another bus up to Galloway Road for our Fogo to pick up his bags. He never left home without collecting another pocket money from his mother, or saying later to Naisha. Then we stopped around the corner to collect snacks for free, as he was loved by the lady's daughter who sells in the shop around the corner. The years passed by, but in 2003, Fogo became a father of his first daughter, Kavia Fogo, which was born of Kerri-Anne Clifford, the then love of his life. Yes, Fogo was quite a charmer as he placed his rod on his mouth to suck his tongue, a trait most girls found appealing as he looked at them, winked his eyes, and smiled as a little cute boy. I can say that Fogo had many love of his life. And many can say that growing up, they were his favorite. But I can tell you that the day he met Raquel Hayden in January 2005, his wife, was the day he started to become the man all of us here today grew to love and adore even more. I recall him telling me, "James, I meet a girl there. Eat this." I laughed and said, "Whatever." As I knew Fogo, myself, Shane and Apple, I've been in and out of love so many times with so many girls. It's not like Molly or Atlan or Beast, but always been a one burner. That's what me I tell. Even though Fogo was very proactive and was always striving, he was never a very healthy chap. Many of you knew him by the size he is on the program cover today. But we knew him, as old people would say, when he would catch water in his collarbone. Fogo loved a lot, but his heart was never strong. His thyroids were taken out. He was hypertensive and had diabetes. He's been in and out of the hospitals many times, both as a child and as an adult. But that did not hinder him from living a wholesome life before and during his marriage. There were many days when Fogo was in pain and he said nothing. He trod on, because family is important. I recall even when he broke his leg while coming down the stairs. And even while he was in the hospital, he was still conducting business, calling on his then business partner, Osborne Solomon, aka Shane, aka Goldfish, to come in and sort business out. Fogo is never without a brother, never without a right hand or a left hand. He married to Raquel Hayden on February 13, 2010, a union which sprung two seeds, Omarr and Omarr Fogo Jr. But notwithstanding, Danielle Murray Richards, the daughter he walked down the aisle, and Danica Murray, both of whom he would drive from St. Elizabeth to Kingston to check on while his wife was at work. Yes, Fogo loved family. He maintained close contact with his father, Raphael, and his sister, Charmaine Fogo, and even his stepbrother, Dwayne, with his father's wife's son. Omarr, once again I say, Fogo loved family. Omarr gained several awards in school, cadet and area youth, and he flooded many stages with colorful lights to show shows in Jamaica, England, USA, Canada, and even the Caribbean. But today, his light is shining through the joy he brought to his mother, father, sisters, wife, children, and yes, grandchildren, aunties, uncle, cousins, and many brothers and friends. Omarr Fogo took his flight September 17, 2021, leaving behind mother Joyce White, father Raphael Fogo, sister Naisha and Charmaine, stepbrother Dwayne, his darling wife Raquel Hill Fogo, daughters Danielle, Danica, Kavia, Omarr, and son Omarr Fogo Jr., grandkids Elise and David Richards, countless
brothers, aunties, uncles, friends, and colleagues. Rest well on your journey, brother and friend, Omarr Fogo. Thank you. Let us all please stand. Tune your voices with me to sing this little chorus. I want to go home to that land. I want to go home to that land. I want to go home to that land where I am from. Oh, it brings joy to my soul, peace and happiness in my heart. I want to go home. Is a miracle in and of itself. Amen.
Amen.
I rest on the day. I rest on hills to climb. I rest on every day. Oh, some of them alone. But when I look around and think things over, oh yeah, all of my good days, I'll dream of
You see, sometimes the clouds hang low. I can hardly see the road. I wonder if you understand. I ask the question, Lord. Tell me why so much pain. But God knows what's best for me. More than my weary eyes could ever see. So I just say, thank you, Lord. Oh, I won't complain. You see, God's been good to me. He's been so good to me. Much more than this whole world could ever be. He's been so good to me. Much more than this whole world could ever be. He's been so good to me.
Some things that have to keep going on. What it means to have almost given up. But God kept me. Oh God. Last night, I was visiting a friend, pronouncing her father dead. Planning to come here to speak today. After leaving my house, taking care of my father who had a stroke last week. You see, the reality of it is that life happens to everybody. Can I talk to you? I'm not going to be long. You can sit. You can sit. I'm going to read one verse. And it's taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 90. And it says, if in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. Hallelujah to Jesus. I want you to turn to somebody beside you and just look them in the eye for emphasis so that it sticks in their mind and say, I have hope. Blessed God, we thank you today for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. I thank you for the opportunity just to worship and fellowship with these people, your people, God. And I thank you for the grace that you have shown and the strength that you have given to them during this time of bereavement. Speak to me, Lord God. a clear understanding that somebody will be blessed, somebody will be set free. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Amen. I wonder to myself sometimes how it is that the world has become what it has become, where there is so much sadness and grief. It seems sometimes as if sadness overwhelms joy. It seems sometimes as if hunger overwhelms feasting. It seems sometimes as if war overwhelms peace. God. And I ask the question, what is the problem with the world? And I submit to you today that the world is suffering from disease. And the worst disease in the world is not cancer. No, it's not. You mentioned hypertension, diabetes, it's neither of those. It's not heart disease. Somebody said maybe it's COVID-19, but it's not COVID-19. Somebody said it's sick, but I don't think it is sick. I think the worst disease in the world today is hopelessness. You see, the solution for sin is easy. What shall we do to be saved? It's simple, just repent. Come on now, somebody. Don't complicate the issue. Just say, I'm sorry, and change. That's what God asks us to do. But one of the things I have seen in the world is that whether you're saved or unsaved, baptized or not baptized, everybody is struggling to find some hope. Oh, somebody said, what is hope? Hope is the expectation that things will get better. It's as simple as that. And when you have been dealing with child after child, stress after stress, grief after grief, and problems after problems, where can I find some hope? Is severe because a man who is without hope is dangerous. If there is no expectation of a better tomorrow, then what value do I have today? If there is no expectation of change for the better, then I might as well do whatever it pleases me to do in the moment. Because it's not going to get. The value of life fades when there's no hope. You see, it's easy to shed innocence when there is no hope. Because if anything happens, I just can I talk to somebody? They're killing our youths in the street as if killing them is going to solve the crime problem. Oh God, can I talk to somebody? I know. They are changing. Until nobody has any rights anymore, as if that's when the sun. can believe that God can bless you. I can believe that. Because I've been blessed.
Amen.
You see, I know what it was like growing up, not having enough. And yet there were people worse than I was. I know what it was like to have a hole in your shoe. Even though it would not be obvious to others. Because they say, Father, teacher, it seemed like everything was alright. But can I tell you that for some people, when it looks alright on the outside, they are dying on the floor. I told you. Some people may be saying, looking good. As if you got to get about on the inside, you're just trying to hold up. Oh God. I know what it feels like. I remember my father used to drive an old VW. And you know, when I was growing up as a boy, I didn't know it was possible to have a car that you could just start with a key. I thought it was a normal thing for people to have to push the car. There will never be way anywhere. You have to find a little hill to park on the hill so that when it's ready to go, you don't have to run it down the hill and shoot.
Success.
You you're still going to have to deal with some problems. Because I've had to counsel people who had nothing who were depressed. And I've had to counsel people who had everything but were still depressed. Can I talk to somebody in the house of God? Oh, Jesus. I did not see a situation where somebody could pay their way out of a casket. Have you seen it? Because I've seen some rich men there. And let me tell you, the rich man did look so different from the poor man did. It's dead and dead. So what I realize is that life and seasons happen to every man. And when the troubles of life begin to rage, and you ask yourself the question, what is the point of living? There has to be something more than this. Oh, I need somebody to understand that no matter how pretty we are, there comes a time when all beauty shall vanish away. I'm gonna need to get somebody to understand that no matter how much money we have in the bank, there will come a time when the money will have no use. Oh God, and we will ask the question, what is the point? Ah, good people die. I'm listening to the life of my brother here, and I respect him even though I don't know him well, based on what I have seen of others. Can I talk to you? But he's still there. And there are wicked people who are alive. And you ask God the question, how do you choose who lives and who dies? Oh God, and you said, what is the point? So now, if we're going to make something of this life that we're given, I've got to have some hope that there must be more than this. Can I talk to somebody? This is the situation now that the Apostle Paul is writing about. And he is engaging the Corinthian church in the discussion. And he is saying to them, you have done many great things, because they were noted for their wisdom and their brilliance. They have achieved great philosophical discourse. They achieved many great things through wealth. They achieve things through education and science. But when it's all said and done, as Solomon said, all is vanity and vexation of spirit. So now we came to the conclusion that if it is in this life alone that we have hope, then we are of all men most miserable. Can I talk to some people who are miserable today? Oh God. The reason some of us are so miserable is that we are hedging everything on today and now. But there are some people who understand that even if things are down now, one day they will be up. Oh, can I talk to somebody in your house? Understand that I may be depressed now, but I serve a God who is able to take me from the mire clay and place my feet on the rock. Oh, Lord Jesus, can I talk to somebody in the house who has not lost hope, but is holding on to the fact that there is a God in heaven? He is the same God who said, let there be light, and here he is the same God that separated the water from the child. The John said in the book of St. John, he said, in the beginning was the Word, and the word was not, and by him were all things made that were made. Can I talk to somebody? It is the same God who on flesh, for God so loved the world that he gave his, that whosoever believeth in him should possess everlasting life. So even if the body is in the casket, there is a God. Can I tell somebody something? It's not Easter, but I'm going to tell you an Easter story. It was Jesus who they brought to the cross. He could have called 10,000 angels, but he humbled himself and he died for the sin of you and I. You and you and you. And you and you and you. Omarr Fogo. Omarr Fogo. Omarr Fogo. Whatever the name you call, he died for you. He died until everything stood still. The sun refused to shine. The veil in the temple was ripped. And when he died, he was buried. Can I talk to somebody? And for 3 days, it seemed as if there was no hope. You see, some of us are going through some stuff now. We are grieving, feeling like there is no hope. For 3 days, it seemed as if there was no hope for Jesus. His disciples had given up hope. His family had given up hope. But early Sunday morning, before the break of day, the scripture says, up, 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 from the grave he arose with power and authority. All things were subject unto him. I'm saying to you that if you lack the same power that raised Jesus from the dead, is here to fill you and you, so that now, no matter how bad things get and how low you may feel, there will always be hope, even on the deathbed. When I'm dying and dying, there is still hope. I'm almost finished, so if you understand, get up on your feet and give God some praise in this place. Please let you know that even though you are messed up, it is your qualification to help somebody else. Please let you know that even though you are a sinner and a worse guy, he will forgive you of your sin. just know. It's not because it's easy, but something on the inside, you didn't know where it came from. Where did the strength come from?
At the time, Deval was a sergeant, right?
Sorry, yes. Right, and we went there, and we mean the most junior persons against sergeants and staff sergeants and people who in rank and these things, you know? And when you're feeling ashamed, because we had one stripe and everybody has a separate. And we were like, yo, we can't compete against them people. Until somebody said, all ranks are null and void. You will wear a number. Fogo being Fogo, immediately went over and started tearing off people's ranks. They didn't like him from it. He was marked.
Yes.
Number one chosen again.
Yes.
I saw him, was sitting beside him, so I was his friend. I was number two. We went to Newcastle. Fogo and I were very similar. We were from the inner city, and it was cadet that brought us together and caught up. And glad to see that at staff, I joined the rank now. Because I witnessed one of my friends, who was a part of the rank now, killed in front of my face, right in class, gun and water, carries his sword. You know? Yeah, that was a life-changing experience. I never saw that before in my life. I saw it in movies. You know? And when we were at Newcastle, because we kept our boat in such immaculate condition, as James said, I thought Fogo doing something that I didn't know, or Fogo didn't know than I did too. The morning we were going on the parade, I thought Fogo was in a socks, rubbish, not basically cheating, rubbing his shoes and getting it mirror shine. And I went like, yo. And trouble meets trouble. And from that day, we were inseparable. Because I then found out that Fogo was on Galloway Road. I was on Latour Avenue, one avenue apart. The girl that James told you about, that if Fogo went to get his transfer, was the same girl I liked too. Because I went to get my stats going at me. After me. Yeah, anyway. Love would have been that we met up at the shop. Yeah, yeah, we go back camp. You know, we collect the thing now. Like what well. And you know, found that Fogo like her, I like her. At the end of the day, what did we do? Did we fight? Did we no. Call a truce. Fogo was a fierce competitor. We were going on parade. Trench stone and stats.
Right.
In the same battalion, but we were rivals.
Yes.
We supported each other. We came to each other's parades.
Yes.
Fogo came while at Newcastle. We were both getting dressed to go on the final parade. There was a thing on my uniform that I didn't see. Fogo stopped me. This was my competitor. Take it off. Turn on Malik. Yeah. Love would have been that I was behind Fogo. His berry was undone. Fogo, turn on. Fogo was the most loyal person I have ever come across. I am lucky to have the friends that I have. I have the same friends now that I had back then. Appleby, Shane, aka Goldfish. Camille, she was also in Kenya. My spouse, James, I see many faces here that I haven't seen in the lab as well. I got to tell Fogo that we have a group, all of us checking in the group time to time, and we told each other, as men, thank you for what you've been to each other. Love it. Fogo's last message was like, blessings, man, take care of yourself. He and I have similar medical issues. Fogo was in the hospital for a broken foot. I was in the hospital for a torn ligament. Fogo was in there for his heart. I was in there for a kidney. Fogo going there for the fibroids. I went in there for two strokes. I still can't believe I'm here. I don't know why I'm here. But I can tell you this. If I could give that you would. It's not my name, it's good.
Forgive me. You are short on my time. If I could do that, pass as a death is death. Can I accept it for God? That name like Fogo, who can I forget it? Coming around with that name like Fogo, really? Fogo, how much of us know a Fogo? The amount of care that we care that you never once fought or cuss and said, don't call me that. That would be called worse. You know? So, publicly to my friends, especially Applegreen James, Chin, love you guys. Glad to see you. Sad that this was what brought us together. Remember we were planning to have our families meet each other when Fogo was alive, because the kids don't know each other. I'm asking you, please, make it up. Alright? So, God bless, and thank you all for coming.
Amen. And Mali is right. Let's not wait until funerals to come together. Forget about COVID. Practice your protocols, yes. Go back to cleanliness. But link up. Don't let the trials of this life, what is going on in society, let us stop being human beings. Human beings love fellowship. We will enjoy coming together. Let's start all over again. Let's start coming together. Let not let them turn us into computers. And we're only speaking to each other via social media. Let's change that. I'm gonna ask the family, you have to be careful now. Can we ask the family to come forward? The entire auditorium will come forward. And then who went to the prayer? Let me ask the immediate family to come forward for prayer. Mom, sister, wife, auntie, children. But the wife is so busybody, just strong woman. She's still running up and down organizing. Put your hands together for her. If you don't understand the program, he said, James. It's not an index sense. Kavia. Omarr. Omarr Fogo Jr. In God spoke to the Abdul. Probably find a girl, you know? Where's Kavia?
I am praying.
I'm struggling to believe that. Is this folly?
Yeah. Hallelujah! Hey! Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Hey! Hallelujah! 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 Hey! Hallelujah! 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 Glory, 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 glory! Glory! Glory, glory! Hey! Hallelujah! Hey! Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Hey! Hallelujah! Hey! Hallelujah! 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 Glory! Glory, glory! Glory, glory! Hallelujah! Hey! Hallelujah! Hey! Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Hey, Jesus! 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 Hey, Jesus! Hey, Jesus! Hey, Jesus! Hallelujah! 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 Jesus! 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 Hey, hallelujah! Hey, glory, 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 glory! Hey, glory to God! Glory to God! Glory to God! Jesus!
The Spirit of God is here.
Amen.
As we're here, I feel the Lord speaking to my heart that this is a blessed family. And what we have to understand is whenever there is a strong blessing on an individual, a family, or a community, the enemy fights even harder to destroy. Because his intention is to do nothing but to kill, steal, and to destroy. So we're going to pray for these persons gathered here. And if you love them, I want us to be on one accord. Because we're not just praying for them, we're praying for their offspring and everybody who is to come from this group. Because the enemy wants to destroy. That's what I'm feeling in my spirit. But the blood of Jesus is stronger. Amen. Anybody believe that? If you believe that, stretch forth your hand. Blessed Father, we come before you this afternoon. We call upon you, God, because you are the source of strength. You are the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end. You are the author and the finisher of the faith of all men. Lord, thank you for your revelation. I've seen the blessing that you have placed upon this group. For so many years, the enemy is trying to afflict them, to steal what God has given them, afflict them with diseases of the mind, diseases of the body, diseases of the spirit. But today we come against it in the name of Jesus. Lord, we cancel every generational curse.
Yes, Lord.
Whatever mistakes that were made before, we erase it in the name of Jesus. Whatever ties that were made that were against your will, we break it in the name of Jesus. We lay down every altar in the name of Jesus Christ. Oh God, we come against every principality, every power, spiritual wickedness in high places that deals have been made with for success. but you are the only source of success, God. Lord Jesus, because every other success is temporal and will pass. But he that doeth the will of the Lord shall endure forever. And so today we bring them before you, God. Touch every grieving heart, every confused mind right now. Set them free in the name of Jesus. Then set them as the examples that you want them to be. And that others may see their good works and glorify your name. And God, we will not take the credit for ourselves. I want you to look at me. Look at me. Every one of you who are standing here, turn around and look at me. Every single one. That when God does it for you, don't take the credit for yourself. But give God the glory. Bless your name. Put your hands together, everyone. Bless you all. Bless you.
May be seated. May be seated. Quick announcement. For those who are on the live stream, we will be breaking for an hour as we make our way to the graveside. I'm going to ask that you refresh your page in an hour. It will only take us an hour to get there. So just refresh your page in an hour. Let us all please stand. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansion bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. Oh, when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be.
When we go see Jesus,
we'll sing and shout the victory. While we walk up in great valley, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sound. Oh, when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize soon. Thank you. But some will be moving on with us to the graveside. To the trench, the staff, the principal and staff of the Trenchtown Polytechnic College, to Winters and Sons Funeral Home, and to Pastor Dr. Leroy Campbell for taking time out of his busy schedule to come and worship with us. And for all family, friends, well wishers, thank you. We now depart to the graveside. Thank you.
on behalf of the Hero Youth Foundation and all the crew members, thank you. On behalf of the family, thank you. Thank you.
I just wanted to say thank you, everyone, for being a part of this. I just wanted to say thank you, everyone, for being a part of this. I really appreciate the support. So thank you.
Yes, I didn't know you. Streaming about to close, that's why I said something.
Streaming about to?
Streaming about to close, that's why I said something.
Close?
Yeah, live streaming.
Oh! Yes, good evening, Peter. Afternoon.
Oh.
Well, I just arrived, but I was coming from Westmoreland and I was watching the funeral. It was a wonderful celebration. Boy, it's hard to say sorry. It's hard to say Fogo. Boy, I'm lost for words. Fogo is one of my cadet friend, Virgin. The last time I spoke to Fogo was like a month before he passed away. I remember saying to Fogo, he was asking me for Derek. He was asking me for a direction for some right here. Okay. Yeah, for a specific place. And we spoke for about 10 minutes. It was actually catching up from school days. And honestly, when I heard about his passing away, it actually shot my brain. Because knowing that Fogo, I never know that, but we spoke at least a night on the WhatsApp group, the cadet group. And when I got the message that Fogo passed away, it was actually I have a nightmare the same night. But actually, I know that he's gone to a better place, and right now it's not really a farewell for Fogo for me. It's actually a celebration. Celebrate his life. I know that he has lived his life to the fullest. You understand? And I should say condolence to his family, his wife and his kids and his immediate family and thing. But know yourself. God is there and God know what is best. You understand me? So all I can say is sleep well, Fogo. Bless you.
Hi everybody, I just want to say thank you all for tuning in today, and I too want to say that Fogo has lived a big life and that he has left a wonderful legacy behind, and we hope, you know, that we'll just continue to let his legacy live on. So we're just giving God thanks that, you know, he was a servant of the Most High God, and today is fine. So thanks be to Almighty God. Praise God. Thank you.
Hola, don't hang up.
Close up.
Oh, hi everyone. Just want to say thank you, a big thank you. I appreciate all of you, your time that you have spent in this moment with me. I would encourage everyone, do not scatter roses after your loved ones are gone. Take this as an opportunity every day that you get up and you see them. Remember to tell them, I love you, I love you, I love you. Cherish your loved one, cherish your loved one. Take it from me, who have been there, done that. I haven't regret a day of my life being together with my husband, the late Omarr Anthony Fogo. I tell him every day how much I love him. He expressed his love to me every day. So that's why I can rejoice even now. And I have God as my strength. I remember 3 days after his passing, I was praying and the Lord said to me, Philippians 4 verse 13, I can do all things through Christ who has strengthened me. And Philippians 4 verse 13 has taken me through this very trying time. Again, I thank you, I thank you, I thank you. God bless you all.